numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back.
Hello and welcome to the Darksides take on 2016 and how it stands for women. While 2016 was in a lot of respects a bad year overall, here's some of the things that struck women particularly hard this year. Congress renews threats to defund Planned Parenthood. In January, Congress voted to defund the women's health organization, Planned Parenthood, for an eighth time in the past year. The bulk of Planned Parenthood services are providing things like cancer and STD screenings to low-income women. But the organization has been demonized by anti-abortion lawmakers. President Barack Obama vetoed the bill, which would have dismantled the Affordable Care Act as well. But House Speaker Paul Ryan vowed that Republican lawmakers will persist. So next year, if we're sending the bill to a Republican president, it will get signed into law. Obamacare will be gone. It's just a matter of time, he said. With Donald Trump in the White House, Ryan might just get his wish. And while we're on the subject of women's reproductive rights, there's this. Texas requiring fetal remains to be cremated or buried. Though the Supreme Court's made a landmark ruling supporting abortion rights in 2016, abortion rights in America continues to be threatened, and likely will face an even greater threat under Trump's administration. One of the most egregious new restrictions is Texas' new rule that requires fetal remains to be handled like a dead person's, in the name of public safety. It requires the burial or cremation of fetal remains. Critics, which include the Center for Reproductive Rights, argue that the regulation does nothing to protect women and makes it harder for them to obtain abortions by increasing the stigma and cost of an abortion. The CRR has filed a lawsuit demanding the state halt the implementations of the new requirements, which were to go into effect December 19th. Indiana and Louisiana have passed similar measures, but have not enacted them due to lawsuits challenging the laws. Stanford rapist Brock Turner receives a lenient sentence, and in a powerful victim impact letter, stated he has made women at Stanford and across California less safe. Stanford law professor Michelle Dauber said of Judge Aaron Persky's light sentence. The judge bent over backwards in order to make an exception, and the message to women and students is, you're on your own. The message to potential perpetrators is, I've got your back. And in addition, a report on gender-based violence commissioned by the European Union found that 27% of 30,000 participants believed rapists sometimes justified. The attitudes varied from country to country, with 60% of respondents in Romania believing rape is sometimes okay, to 22% in the UK. Let's move on to Roger Ailes. Roger Ailes facing a slew of sexual harassment allegations. Former Fox News anchor Gretchen Carlson alleged sexual harassment against former Fox head Roger Ailes in a lawsuit that exposed a culture of harassment and intimidation at one of the most influential media companies in the world. 15 days after Carlson's lawsuit filed in July, Roger Ailes was ousted, and later Fox settled for $20 million. But what should have been a career-killing public embarrassment was barely a setback, as Trump quickly grabbed him as campaign advisor. Trump supported Ailes, remarking that it was very sad that women with whom Ailes had helped were suddenly saying these horrible things about him. And just as bad, rather than grappling with the issues brought to the surface, Fox News has been quick to move on from the scandal. Women accomplishments at the Olympics are underscored by sexist commentary. When Hungarian swimmer Katinka set a world record in the 400-meter individual medley, NBC's Dan Hicks credited her coach and husband. When U.S. women's trap shooter Corey Cogle Unrein took home a bronze medal, the Chicago Tribune didn't even mention her name. The paper described her only as the wife of a Bears lineman. The paper has since apologized. One BBC commentator described a woman's judo event as a catfight. There are just a few examples of the sexist commentary used that trivialized the accomplishments of women at the Rio Olympics. Racist trolls force Leslie Jones off Twitter. After a misogynistic campaign that turned the trailer for the all-female Ghostbusters reboot to the worst-performing YouTube trailer of all time, the very funny Ghostbusters remake tanked in theaters, and angry men began to repeatedly harass film co-star Leslie Jones. Twitter eventually banned Breitbart's Milo, an emerging leader of the white supremacy movement, for encouraging his followers to attack Jones. In August, hackers released private nude photos of Jones and copies of her passport and driver's license online and promoted racist memes. Leslie Jones has since closed down her Twitter account. When Tucker Carlson attacked Teen Vogue writer Lauren Duca on TV, Fox News hack Tucker Carlson had Teen Vogue writer Lauren Duca on and did what he does best, talked over her for about half the interview. They were there to talk about Duca's tweets about Ivanka Trump, but instead was a bunch of guffawing and obfuscating by Carlson. Luckily, Duca is whip smart and called Carlson on his shit repeatedly, leading to a pathetic humiliation of a career blowhard. Muslim women wearing hijabs are targeted as Islamophobia rises. Muslims in America have been dealing with a dramatic uptick in hate crimes and harassment in recent years, and Donald Trump's proposed ban on Muslims has intensified the bigotry. In September, Mick reported that Islamophobia in America is worse on 9/11/2016 than it was on 9/11/2001. Muslim women wearing hijabs are particularly vulnerable, with many reporting faced increased harassment post-election. In France, over two dozen towns banned burkinis, swimwear worn by some Muslim women, from its beaches. The law was overturned in at least one town, as other towns faced challenges to the law. In November, Representative Jason Spencer, a Republican state representative in Georgia, proposed a bill that would have effectively banned Muslim women from wearing a headscarf in public. Fortunately, he scrapped the bill 2 days later after public outcry. Minnesota's Ihan Omar, who recently made history as the first America's first Somali American lawmaker, said that on a recent visit to Washington, D.C., a cab driver called her ISIS and threatened to take off her hijab. And then, of course, we have the worst perpetrator of sexism and misogyny, Donald Trump. Let's start with former Miss Universe Elisa Mercado, who is from Venezuela. In 2016, she became a U.S. citizen and cast her vote for Hillary Clinton. Mercado became one of the fiercest critics of Trump's treatment of women and his racist rhetoric against the Latino community, alleging that he called her Miss Piggy and Miss Housekeeping when he ran the Miss Universe pageant in 1996. After Clinton mentioned Mercado during the first presidential debate, Trump continued to fat shame her, justifying his behavior to Fox and Friends by saying she gained a massive amount of weight and it was a real problem. The message he sent to the American people is no fat chicks. Sexism was a major theme of Donald Trump's presidential campaign, with supporters crying Trump that bitch and the candidate accusing Hillary Clinton of playing the woman's card. He also routinely made sexist comments towards women on the campaign trail, like Ted Cruz's wife Heidi, political opponent Carly Fiorina, and news anchor Megyn Kelly, and of course, Hillary Clinton herself. Is this what we're teaching these kids? Is an appropriate way to treat women that you don't agree with? Asked Republican strategist Katie Packer, who served as Mitt Romney's deputy campaign manager in 2012. And there hasn't been a peep from the campaign about this stuff being offensive. And so, by not addressing it, they have encouraged it. October was one shitty, triggering month for survivors of sexual assault who who were forced to listen to Donald Trump brag about sexual assault, and then hear him and his surrogates dismiss it as locker room talk, and then witness Trump's attempt to discredit sexual assault allegations brought forward against him by more than one dozen women, and suggest that they weren't real issues. The news cycle was traumatizing for millions of sexual assault survivors, many of whom felt re-victimized by seeing the victim-shaming conversations that Trump and his supporters were having on the TV and in media. It wasn't just Hillary Clinton's loss that devastated women across the country. It was the realization that for the next 4 years, Donald Trump, a man who boasts about sexual assault, calls Mexicans rapists, amongst other things, will be the President of the United States. The 2016 election has revealed just how deep America's racial and gender fault lines are. And with his cabinet and senior advisor picks, the news for women continues to get worse. Trump has appointed Steve Bannon, former chairman of Breitbart, who called his site the platform of white supremacy, a movement made up of white supremacists. Bannon is not a fan of feminism either, having called the women's liberation movement a bunch of dykes that came from the Seven Sisters school up in New England, and was accused of domestic violence in 1996 by his ex-wife. The case was later dropped. Trump has vowed to nominate judges who oppose abortion, with Vice President Mike Pence saying he hopes we send Roe v. Wade to the ash heap of history. Trump has nominated Georgia Representative Tom Price as the Secretary of Health and Human Services, who is so anti-abortion that in 2005, he supported a personhood bill that effectively would have turned many forms of contraception, IUDs, the morning after pill, and good old hormonal birth control pills, into potential implements of murder in the eyes of the law, as well as outlawing most abortions. And when House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi tried to address women's issues with Trump, he handed the phone to his daughter Ivanka. So in parting, I'd just like to say we must try to fight this on every level, by casting votes for people that are friendly to women's issues. Start with your families and communities. Raise your boys to see women as equals and not as mere eye candy. Raise your daughters to reach for the sky and not just be satisfied with being a second-class citizen. Make an impact wherever you are and with whomever you come in contact with. Thank you. Have a great day. Yes.